Joe Rogan, thank you for coming. Your first podcast.
My pleasure, Tim Dillon. Thank you for having me.
I like the way you do this. We come to your studio.
It's easy.
We sit here. We do it. Jamie has to work extra. He's not happy about it.
Jamie's
but
happy.
But that's okay. All right. That's all right. Thank you for letting me do. We wanted to follow up Lex Fridman with somebody bigger. And that person is you.
Oh,
and
then, thank you.
And it's. I wanted to ask you, because it's been, you know, we were just talking about the Hamptons and how crazy people go when they have an insane amount of money.
Yeah.
You've done very well in the last, forever, but in the last year.
Yeah.
Do you, is it weird as a comic, the types of people that you can be around now? Or
it's weird, I'll get like messages from celebrities, like random celebrities, usually about COVID advice.
Right.
Like I get, no bullshit, I've helped like dozens of people.
Yeah.
That I've never brought their names up, like famous actors.
Right.
Musicians. To just contact me for COVID advice.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's weird. But it's also weird that they can just, they know I know them and I'm famous too. So
right.
We're all, like, I've reached this weird spot where I feel comfortable meeting famous people. Like, hi, fellow famous person.
Right.
Whereas I was plagued by imposter syndrome, like, for forever. Like, and I would get real weird around actual celebrities. I'm like, I gotta run to the store.
Right.
Hang out with the freaks. You know,
but now you're cool with it.
It's more. I'm just more accustomed to it, I guess. But the money thing and the celebrity thing and all that stuff, it is odd, and it's not good for a comedian. Comedians are best off known, but not too famous,
right?
Because you get too famous, and then you get scrutiny from people who aren't even really fans, and they
right.
start picking about your material or looking for, you know, where you've aired on the PC
right.
side,
right?
And, you know, and where you're not woke or where this.
What do you think that is with comics? Where if they get too much money or if they get too big, a lot of them lose their mind.
Yeah.
A lot of them have real big problems.
Well, famous people lose their mind.
Right.
It's just a totally unnatural state of existence.
Right.
Where everywhere you go, people know you and they're all happy to see you.
Right.
And then you also surround yourself with a bunch of people that don't tell you the truth. That's pretty common.
Right.
And you got to find a way to mitigate that or you'll go insane.
Right.
You have to have something you do that's like an absolute thing, whether it's a workout thing or you play chess or you fucking, you know, whatever it is. You have to have something that you do that's really difficult.
Yeah.
That doesn't give a fuck if you're famous.
Right.
If you don't have, like,
yeah.
I look at it literally like it's an exercise for maintaining sanity. Like this, you have to brush your teeth, you have to go work out.
Right.
Yeah, but it's not just you work out to be healthy, it's also work out because it's so hard to do
right.
that everything else seems easier.
Right. Over the last year, you've kind of become, is this the most heat you've ever taken for a position? For about COVID
stuff?
About the vaccine and stuff like that, is there, because I know that the trans MMA thing was big, but it didn't feel this big.
Well, the trans MMA thing was big, but it wasn't valid. It was people that don't want any criticism whatsoever about trans people. And I was like, look, I don't have a problem with trans people.
Right.
I have a problem with someone pretending that they're a biological woman and fighting women.
Right.
Once you say you're trans and everybody says, okay, I'll fight her, fine. I'm fine
right.
with that. And in fact, MMA is one of the best places for that because you know exactly who your opponent is.
Right.
Unlike like this swimmer. Was it UPenn? Is that what it is?
I don't know.
Whatever the swimmer is, it's like lapping all these biological women.
Right.
That's fucked.
Right.
Because they don't have a choice. They have to compete
yeah.
against
and fighting them. Is you're more of an expert in fighting than many things.
Yeah,
right? This is you put your knowledge of fighting up there. And the knowledge of advantages that a biological male has over a female.
They're giant. The
right.
advantages are giant. And I don't think they go away
right.
in 2 years of, you know, hormone
right.
treatments and surgery.
Right.
It's too much of an advantage. But if a woman is a biological woman who wants to compete against a trans woman, I have zero problem with
right.
that. And there was a situation like that recently.
Yeah.
I had no comment about it.
Right.
It's basically some regional level fighters. And one was trans, and she was a former, like, Navy SEAL, like, fucking super jacked.
Right,
like,
yeah.
Used to look like
Right.
You know, like a savage.
Yeah.
And then became a woman and fought MMA. And,
right.
But apparently it was a good fight, too. She almost lost in the first round, won in the second round. I don't care.
Right.
My issue's not, it's not an anti-trans position. It's like,
for sure,
you can't pretend that that's fair, that you don't
right.
tell someone that you were a biological male for 30 fucking years.
Right.
So 30 fucking years of having testosterone pulsing through your system and strengthening your tendons and your muscles and changing the way your mind works. It's
right.
It's a different mind than
yeah,
a female
absolutely.
Mind.
Absolutely.
That's, so that was a lot
that
of
that was a big one.
But it was more like, I realize that people will distort your perceptions on things or your positions on things. This is different. This is like the government gets mad at me.
Right.
Like, this is crazy.
This is the most
CNN
heat
lies about me. Yeah.
I think I've ever seen a private individual take outside of like somebody who's leaking secrets or something, right? I mean, this
yeah.
is a pretty, now obviously you're fine. They're not, you know, they're not disappearing you, right? But in terms of just criticism, You know, Fauci and the, you know, people have addressed you personally, you know, like the media has kind of gone after you personally. Does it affect you at all being in the midst of this shitstorm on the level you're in it, which is pretty, you're pretty central?
Well, it has to affect you because you're aware of it. If you're aware of it, it has an effect on you. The question is, do you change the way you operate? Like, do I
right.
decide that now I'm going to play it safe and I'm going to just have podcasts with athletes or comedians, just talk about silly things?
Right.
I could do that.
Right.
I could just decide to bail out of it. Or I could just do exactly what I want to do.
Right.
And do exactly what got me here in the first place. So that's what I do.
Yeah.
I'm aware of it, but I'm like,
right.
You know. It's, I know what's going on too. You know, what's going on, it's one of the reasons why they go after me is that they realize I have a lot of influence. Another reason why is because they need a boogeyman. Like, the mainstream media needs a Trump. They need a
right.
someone. They need,
right.
because on their own, the problem is, it's a lot of it is editorial opinion pieces by morons. Like,
right.
they're really dull-minded folks.
These are not the brightest.
Well, the reason why they got there in the first place is not because they're these courageous, pioneering thinkers
right.
who have, like, compassionate, intelligent views in the world. No, they've followed narratives. They read teleprompters.
Yeah. Right.
And they say things that align with whatever the ideology is of their network.
Right.
So that's what they do.
Do you have people that disagree with you on this issue that, and I'm sure you do, that you respect?
Yeah.
That you go, Sam Harris, somebody
yeah.
like that.
Yeah, yeah,
like
yeah.
people
yeah.
that go, I feel, because you know, it's a big issue, and it's like
yeah.
a life or death thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's an important issue. People have very strong feelings about it. Do you, like, obviously there's a lot of disingenuous people in the media that are doing it for clicks, but do you have people in your own life who this is kind of, I don't want to say a rift, but like, have you fallen out with people over it? Or
yes.
have you, okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's controversial. But at this point, particularly when I see the way the government's behaving, the suppression of monoclonal antibodies, the demonizing of generic treatments that are available, whether it's hydroxychloroquine or ivermectin, there's a concerted effort to demonize treatments that many, many, many doctors are using and many
right.
countries are using.
There's
right. fuckery going on, man.
Sure.
And it's brought to you by Pfizer.
Right.
And if you watch
yeah.
the root of this fuckery,
yeah.
it's real clear. And so I'm pretty confident in what I'm saying.
Right.
I'm not saying that you shouldn't get vaccinated, and I'm not saying that vaccines don't have a positive benefit for a lot of people. They most certainly do. A lot of people
yeah.
who got COVID who were vaccinated, it was way better for them than not being vaccinated. That's a fact.
Right.
Another fact is there's treatments that are available that could stop it dead in its tracks, particularly monoclonal antibodies. The Biden administration is doing their very fucking best to make it really hard to get monoclonal antibodies. And according to Peter McCullough, Dr. Peter McCullough, who's the most published physician in history in his field, the most published ever. He's
right.
a rock solid physician without ever having any controversy in his career up until COVID. He says there's enough monoclonal antibodies for the entire country. He's like, they're doing their best to try to prevent this, because if you get that monoclonal antibodies, it stops COVID dead in its tracks.
So why wouldn't I?
Early treatment with monoclonal antibodies knocks it dead. It did it with you.
Yeah.
It did it with me.
Right. And so then why not go that route? Now, I know Pfizer's making a lot of money.
Because they want to vaccinate people.
Right.
They want universal vaccination.
Yeah.
Now, you could ascribe, you could say there's all sorts of like sinister motives for that.
Sure.
You know, you could say they don't want a control group. They want the entire country vaccinated. So if health problems happen, there's no one to compare it to. There's a lot of things that you could say. You could say that this is just a gigantic money grab, that they have some sort of a very close relationship with the pharmaceutical companies that manufacture the vaccines.
Yeah.
I don't know what the fuck it is, but I do know that there are treatments. And in a sane world,
right,
you would be pursuing all these treatments. They wouldn't just send you home,
right,
and say they can't give you ivermectin, they
right,
can't give you anything else. They just come back when your pulse, your blood oxygen level drops below 92. That's not normal.
Right.
That's not normal with any other disease.
Right.
When they
it's
have
not the best
off-label treatments that are available that people are using, and there are randomized controlled trials that show that they work. I don't know if they fucking work or not. I'm a moron. All right.
Right.
I'm not a doctor. I'm not an epidemiologist. I'm not a virologist. But the ones that I've talked to that have treated thousands of people, they tell you time and time again that these are effective methods.
Yeah.
They point to Uttar Pradesh in India that's knocked it out using entirely this combination of ivermectin and a few other off-label drugs. They point to all these different countries all around the world that have experienced very low rates of COVID. And they
right,
say, why does Japan use ivermectin?
Right.
Why do all these other countries use it?
Right.
Why is CNN pretending it's veterinary medication when more people have taken ivermectin than there are horses on planet Earth?
Right.
It's fucking nuts.
But the media has clearly attacked you using a playbook that has only made them look very disingenuous. And you've, I think, more people's eyes have been opened by the media lying about things you've said or misrepresenting ivermectin as horse medication, things like that. In terms of, I think one of the criticisms that people have had is they've said, like, why not bring on people that are more pro-vaccine?
I have.
So you put on
Sanjay
Gupta.
I had him on. I had Rhonda Patrick on. I had a conversation with her about it. In the early days of the podcast, I had Michael Osterholm, who is he's an infectious disease expert. I had Peter Hotez, who's a vaccine expert.
Right.
Quite a few of them on.
Yeah.
The thing is, like, over time, I've noticed that the mainstream narrative is being guided in a way where everybody steps in line and people are ignoring all these other things that we talked about. They're ignoring the suppression of monoclonal antibodies. They're ignoring the suppression of treatments. There's a lot of shit going on.
Have any of those dudes reached out to, like, come back on again? Or have they, like, Osterholm or people like that? Is it weird? Because also people bring up this whole thing that you have where you go, listen, I'm not anti-vax, right?
I'm not.
You have a whole thing where you talk about, like, that a lot of people that are against all vaccinations are historically, you know, they've been proven wrong. Like, we've stamped out a lot of diseases. What about, like, because I would wonder, because
this
I know
this isn't a vaccine.
Right. No, 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 for
it's
sure.
It's a gene therapy. That's part of the problem.
Yeah.
It's kind of an experimental thing.
Yeah.
I mean, the experiment is massive now. It's billions and billions of people worldwide.
Right.
But it's essentially experimental in terms of long-term health consequences.
Why,
for all
so
these
I
people.
Wonder about guys, because like, they don't seem like bad people, Osterholm or guys like that, right?
They've never been bad people.
They've never been bad people. And are they just looking at, well, all these people, a lot of them are faring better with the vaccine if they get COVID, so they're not looking at the other adverse effects?
There's a bunch of things you could say. I mean, it's a lot of it's speculation. But again, there's a lot of people that benefit from being vaccinated. That's a fact.
Right.
There's also people that have horrible reactions to the vaccine. That's a fact, too. Like, there's a lot going on, and when you're only allowed to look at one group of one, you know, example of evidence and not another example, like a positive example versus a negative example, that's not good for anybody.
No, it's not.
It just sucks for me that I'm stuck in this weird position.
You're
where I have
in
to
this
talk
crazy
this.
Position as a comedian, MMA commentator, podcaster. But the show has become such a massive. I mean, they put out numbers the other day. I mean, you're the leading media figure.
How
right now?
Dumb is that?
Well,
that's
it's
how
wild.
You know. That's how
I
you know
think
this
I
world
should
is
be.
Fucked. You should.
I
be.
Was so mad that you were, and I called my producer and I fired him. I had to rehire him because I couldn't find anyone else. But I was so angry. because I don't have guests, and that's what a real media person should do. I have no interest in anyone's opinion. Just like my mother, who's a schizophrenic, she never had to have anyone over to have a good time. And that's the way I do. But you now have a crazy amount of people listening. Do you feel, because people try to guilt you. People try to go, somebody didn't get vaccinated and they died of COVID. And they try to go, that's Joe Rogan's fault. This is what people say.
That's what they say?
Well, that's what they say. I mean, this is their whole thing, right?
This is what I would say. Yeah. Why didn't the doctors give them treatment?
Right.
Why didn't the doctors get them monoclonal antibodies? Why, were they denied monoclonal antibodies? Right. Did they request them? Did they know about them?
Right.
You know, why didn't they get IV vitamin drip infusions? Why didn't they get NAD? Is that available?
Yeah.
Isn't that available? That seems like, especially IV vitamin drips. Like that shit's very available. We know that high level vitamin drips, whether it's with especially with C, D, zinc, glutathione, all those things are like hugely beneficial to any kind of disease people have.
For sure.
I mean, I've got them. I've got them like as a, just a health remedy for the last few years. And every time I do it, it feels fucking great.
And you know people personally that have had problems with the vaccine.
I know quite a few now.
Yeah.
Now I know over 15 people that have had like serious side effects of the vaccine.
Both men and women, menstrual issues, strokes,
neurological disorders, chronic fatigue.
So what's a neurological disorder? Just
your whole body shaking?
Jesus.
Yeah. And you can't do anything about it? Like weird ones, man. The thing is, when you're vaccinating, this to be fair, you're vaccinating hundreds of millions of people in this country alone, you're going to get adverse side effects on any medication.
Right.
The thing is, if you look at only that group, like if you vaccinate 100 million people, they think that the adverse side effects, and they don't really know because the VAERS report, it's very underreported, and it's also hard to see whether or not the it's 100% accurate. I don't know how much they investigate each individual one.
Right.
But if you they seem to think that at a low number, like a conservative number, it's like 1 per 1,000. So if you vaccinate a million people, you're going to have a lot of people that have adverse side effects. You vaccinate 100 people, you're going to have a lot. So this is what we're dealing with.
Yeah. And that doesn't get any play.
It doesn't. They suppress it. There was a kid on TikTok that had myocarditis, and he was a high school kid, like an athlete, and he was in the hospital. And it got millions and millions of plays. They removed it from TikTok because it doesn't fit the narrative. Like, that's what's fucked.
That, see, they that's say that, really an indication of a much larger problem.
Yes.
Yeah,
the problem is they think they're doing good.
I mean, a 13-year-old got it and died a day later.
There's quite a few.
There's a few kids that unfortunately, you know, have passed away.
Yes. I have a friend, and one of his good friend's daughter got it. She was 14 years old and just immediately respiratory failure. They put her in the ICU. She's fucked. You know, there was one of the girls in the trials that was 13 years old. That's confined to a wheelchair
for the rest of her life.
And you know,
and you can't sue. Not that suing would matter when it's your child.
No, you can't. That's part of what's going on. The emergency use authorization, it exempts them from any. And you're talking about these companies that have always historically lied about adverse side effects in order to make profit. They've done it with Vioxx. They've done it with a bunch of other drugs in the past. Pfizer is like one of the most fined companies.
The Russian
ever.
Vaccine Sputnik is actually the best vaccine.
It's supposed to be very good.
It's actually the best vaccine. It's crazy.
And there's another one from Cuba. It's supposed to be very good too.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Cuban one's supposed to be excellent.
Lex Fridman is an agent of Russia. He works for Russia.
Oh, he definitely does.
And he's here in America now.
I think he's related to Putin.
Yeah, he's his son. Lex Fridman is the son of Putin and Ghislaine Maxwell.
His real name's Damien.
Keep it on the low. But he was talking about Sputnik, and I researched Sputnik, and Sputnik is actually good.
Yeah.
Could you, instead of with the ivermectin, just pitch Sputnik?
Well, I
that
think
way
they're
you
going
can divert the people that are angry at you, and you go, all right, I'll give you a vaccine. Get
just
Sputnik.
Get a Russian one. It's the best one.
Get
the Cuban one.
What's a Cuban one called? Do we
I don't know. It's a good question.
James,
there's a new
out.
One that's coming out, apparently, that is it's an inert version of the virus, like an old school vaccine.
So that's what you want.
Well, I don't know, man. I mean, is that good? Is that good to get?
Yeah,
I don't know.
Nobody knows.
Well, here's the thing, man. What about treatments? What about these fucking treatments? How good is this Pfizer pill that's coming out?
Yeah.
How good is the Merck pill that's coming out? Maybe that's the way
Maybe
to go.
They're great.
Maybe a good thing to do is get the natural antibodies from an infection and they have a really effective treatment.
And also, you're right about this. You can't have the body positivity shit.
No.
Where you tell people you can be fat and that it's great for you. No. You shouldn't demonize fat people, but you should also be very honest with them about you're making a choice.
Yes.
Just like when you become a comedian, you're making a choice.
Yes.
It may not work. Statistically, it won't, but you can try, and good luck, right? It's like you become an actor, an artist, whatever. Being fat is kind of similar to that, where it's like, it's probably not going to work. Long term.
It's even worse with COVID, apparently, because there's something about COVID that targets fat.
And it does.
Yeah. And they've shown significant numbers of people that are in the ICU that are overweight. It's it's one of the worst things.
And in the beginning, they weren't as honest with that as they are now.
Well, that's the thing. It's like there's things that upset people. And so because they know those things upset people,
they decide not to talk about it. Right.
And you know, body shaming is one of those things.
Right. But it's true that you have a much higher risk.
Yeah, it's true.
Having adverse reaction to COVID, hospitalization, death, if you're a fatty boom baddie.
Yeah, I think if we're really lucky, these Merck pills or the Pfizer pills are excellent. And then also this Omicron, you know, I have a friend who's a biologist who was talking to me about this. He goes, essentially what this is a live vaccine. It's a vaccine that's burning through the population. It's not, he's saying it's not good to get it. I'm not saying it's good to get it. What I'm saying is it's a respiratory virus, and it's almost inevitable that people are going to get it because of the infectious rate of it. It's super infectious.
Right.
And because it's super contagious, rather, this disease is probably going to get everybody who hasn't gotten COVID yet.
What's driving the entire economy right now is online commerce. And if you are selling anything online, you need to worry only about cultivating new relationships, building a client base. Here's what you don't need to worry about. Shipping. ShipStation.com is your back office. It handles anything. If you sell anything online, I don't need to tell you that shipping can be super frustrating. There are so many carriers and a ton of factors that go into figuring out the best rate for each order. And with most people shopping online every year, the added holiday stress doesn't help. ShipStation makes shipping the easy part of running your online store so you can get back to doing what you're passionate about, growing your business. Easily import orders from every sales channel, whether it's Amazon, eBay, Etsy, or your own website, and automate just about any shipping task, all from an easy-to-use dashboard. Again, you run a business, your main focus needs to be growing that business, baby! I know a guy who had a shipping problem and it ended his marriage. Not good. You don't want that. You're going to get access to discounted rates that are usually reserved for Fortune 500 companies. So not only is shipping easy, you actually save money. No wonder 98% of companies that use ShipStation a year keep using it for as long as they're in business. It's that good. Make this season a little brighter with ShipStation. Use my offer code TimDillon to get a 60-day free trial. Just enough time to handle the holiday rush for next year. Just go to ShipStation.com, click on the microphone at the top, and enter code TimDillon. ShipStation. Make ship happen. Lucy Nicotine is a company founded by Caltech scientists and former smokers looking for a better and cleaner nicotine alternative. Finally, tobacco alternatives that don't suck. Researched and developed for 3 years to be made for people, not patients. Lucy has created a nicotine gum with 4 milligrams of nicotine that come in 3 flavors, wintergreen, cinnamon, pomegranate. Lucy has a lozenge with 4 milligrams of nicotine, cherry ice flavor. Each and every flavor actually tastes great. And it's convenient and discreet. Products can be enjoyed anytime, on flights, at work, on the go, even in the gym. I used to smoke, but then I started using Lucy lozenges, and I haven't had a cigarette in 20 years. It's 2021. Get rid of your cigarettes. Unplug your vape. Throw out your dip. And get some Lucy nicotine gum or lozenges. This is the real deal. A subscription to Lucy comes directly to your door each month. So it's simple. And you don't have to leave your house because Lucy has delivery down. Attention, Tim Dillon Show listeners, go to lucy.co. That's lucy.co. Use promo code TIM to get 20% off all products on your first order, including gum or lozenges. That's lucy.co, promo code TIM. Also, I have to give the disclaimer, warning, this product contains nicotine derived from tobacco. Nicotine is an addictive chemical. Lucy.co, and be sure to use that promo code TIM. Remember, any company that advertises on the show is helping the show. So why don't you help yourself and help the show? Lucy.co, promo code TIM.
What's interesting is that nobody in Hollywood's vaccinated. Nobody talks about it. We know a bunch of actors.
They don't ever talk about it.
None of them are vaccinated, right?
Really?
None of them.
You mean they hide it?
They hide it. They have fake vaccine cards.
Oh,
really? We've been told this by everybody.
I thought you were being facetious.
No, 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 no.
Oh.
A lot of Hollywood actors are not doing it because, you know, they're younger. A lot of them, they're healthier. They have access to really good treatment. This, that, the other thing. They don't trust a narrative, whatever. They're just not. And, you know, outwardly, they're not talking about it, right?
Yeah.
Like, think of how many Hollywood celebrities went hard for Black Lives Matter.
Mm-hmm.
Now, think about how many of them went hard for the vaccine. Not a lot. There's just not a lot of Hollywood
Stephen
people.
Stephen Colbert went hard.
He went hard, but that's his job.
Is it?
Well, he's a puppet. But I mean, that's like
the
marionette.
Puppety thing I think I've ever seen.
Well, he's a guy that took the $25 million a year, which I get. If somebody pays me $25 million a year.
Is that what they give him to host that show?
They give him a lot of money. And he was getting no ratings. And then Trump came in and he goes, my aunt loves Stephen Colbert. You know, she's in her 60s or late 50s. She has three or four autoimmune disorders. She's self-diagnosed. She drinks white Zinfandel and she sits in her chair. She has a loveless marriage and she stares at the TV and Stephen Colbert comes on and he goes, Trump's evil and the Republicans are evil. And she cheers and smacks her seal-like paws together. And this is how she's going to spend the rest of her life. And I have another aunt who does the same thing, but she's a QAnon retard, and she watches Laura Ingraham, and her husband and her are like, you know, it's a loveless, you know, marriage, and she just sits in her chair drinking wine, watching Laura Ingraham and Tucker Carlson. So people at a certain age, I think when they've given up on everything else in life, they get very political.
Yeah, that does happen.
This
gives them meaning.
Gives them purpose. Something to do.
Well, they watch their tribe go to war.
That's
like,
right.
Well, people are into football teams.
That's right.
You know, fucking go Buccaneers.
Right, right.
They get
it's
all
crazy.
Excited.
They paint their chest.
Yes.
They go insane.
It's their team. And if their team loses, they get devastated.
Do you, as a highly productive person, look at people like that and go, they're just lower life forms? Because I'm not even nearly as productive as you, and I look at them like that, and I do a hundredth of maybe a thousandth of what you do, and I look at them and I go, they're like zombies.
Yeah,
their bodies and minds have been taken over.
Well, they got, it's a trap.
Right.
It's like, if you ever watch people play Three Card Monty in New York?
Yes.
And you go, oh, you fucking dummy. Like,
yes.
You're going to get sucked into that?
Yeah.
Like, you'll get sucked into all
these
things.
Right,
you know, it's what I say about, like, if you get really invested in politics. Like, voting for president is probably a lot like rooting on pro wrestling.
That's right.
It might make you feel better,
right,
but I don't know how much it really affects the outcome.
Yeah.
And they're trying to pull that back as
for
much
sure.
as possible now.
I mean, if you look at Biden, who's clearly... You know, this act didn't get passed. Even the Democrats are going, this guy is out of it.
Yeah.
Even people that voted for him are going, hey, something's wrong. It's clear to see that the will of the people gets subverted a lot in many different ways.
Sure.
And the people who end up running the show are not necessarily representative of what the public wants.
Yeah.
And how do you, I don't know that you fix that.
I don't know if you fix that either.
So unfortunately, it's just, you end up adopting this kind of cynical position.
Right.
That you can only really take care of yourself, your family, your community, the people. You can donate money, you can be altruistic in many different ways. But as far as the government, it seems like an unsolvable problem.
It's definitely complex, and it's moving in the wrong direction.
Right.
You know, I've been paying attention to these companies that are buying up affordable housing.
Yeah. Like BlackRock and Zillow.
Yeah, that's scary.
It is scary.
That's scary, because if they can move the entire country into renting, like,
that's right.
Nobody can own anything.
Well, that's what they want to do.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
They don't want anyone to own anything.
If you get a giant majority of the population that are just renters, that don't ever own property, they never have their own real home.
Yeah.
And then you make sure that you control their wage, because you have massive corporations, whether it's Target or Amazon or whatever, and they limit the amount of possible growth you have within a company.
Yeah. And there was that article, you'll own nothing and be happy in 2030.
I've seen that. That is wild.
And this is, you know, kind of, you know, when you look at a lot of these think tanks and, you know, groups of very powerful interests, when you look at the kind of world they want, they would like to get rid of things like car ownership.
Yes, I've been seeing that too.
They want to get rid of home ownership. Yeah. They want people to all be on the grid in a major way. They want surveillance, you know, cradle to grave, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Social credit systems.
Yeah, and the only thing it's left to do seems to be to get in with them. So that when they're doing this to everyone, you're with them.
Yeah, you're on the right side of the plexiglass.
Because here's the problem. People are marching into this willingly. Yeah. They're like marching into it. It's like my aunt or the other aunt. Like, people, as long as their team wins, they don't really care what rights they lose and what things end up looking like.
Yeah, they don't. There's a lot of people that don't. They're so tribal that if the right-wing people want something, they want the opposite of that, even if it kills them. And so I think that there's a lot of exaggerated positions by people that take up these really, like, amplified right-wing positions, and it's probably, like, Russian trolls or Chinese trolls or something like that. And they take up these positions which force the people on the left to get even more crazy with their Marxist ideas and leftist ideas.
They turn it up.
They're being played.
They turn it up.
And very few people are autonomous. Right. Very few people have their own, like...
But we're also a silly country now, so we have kids in the suburbs calling themselves Maoists,
unironically,
in these leafy green suburbs. And then we have the alt-right, and it's the same kids, and they want a return to the Holy Roman Empire. And these are children running around the suburbs that are online all day, venerating these genocidal dictators and going, this is a good idea.
Yeah.
It's a silly country, and there's a lot of problems.
And you know, one of the first indications that I saw that this was coming was when comics stopped doing colleges.
Interesting, yeah.
Because as soon as comics...
you lose the younger people. Yeah.
The comics are like, dude, they're too fucking politically correct. It's too annoying. I don't want to do this. They don't have any world experience, and their ideas are preposterous, and, you know, they don't want... They're like the first to say no one should own property. They're the first to say that
absolutely,
you know, that we need a redistribution of wealth,
right?
And we need,
which a little bit of is good, but you don't want all of it.
Income
because
equality.
Then why make money?
Income equality is a crazy statement.
Of course.
Because should people make more money? Yes.
Yes.
They definitely should.
Sure.
If you look at a corporation that's making fucking untold billions of dollars, and then you go down to the bottom of the chain and people are in dire poverty that are working for that company, and that company is benefiting substantially
more
than that person's.
The balance
is way off. And those people have no leverage.
Yes.
That's where unions come into play.
Right.
That's why it's important
to organize. But that's why Jeff Bezos recently with Amazon, like, he's taking the photos with the girl.
Yeah.
He's enjoying it. At least the Amazon employees, even though they don't have food or health care, can look at him and go, he's having fun. Do you know what
him.
I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas a Warren Buffett, he's just in Omaha having sex with kids quietly and worshiping Satan.
Is that what he's doing?
Come on. Who lives in Omaha that has $1 billion?
He drinks a lot of Coca-Cola.
He's got $100 billion. He lives in Omaha. Why? Because
he lives in a small house.
He says he likes Dairy Queen. Let's cut it out. But Bezos, at least, he's on a raft with these whores in the middle of the ocean. At least that inspires people.
I think it's actually his girlfriend.
Yeah.
She's really pretty.
She's pretty in an interesting way. Kind
what
of.
What does that mean?
There's a shapeliness to her she seems threatening.
Like an animal.
She looks like an agent.
Ah.
Kind of like somebody that would play an agent in a
in a movie, which is interesting because she probably is an agent in real life.
Well, she's
a Mossad agent or something.
Dated a lot of other people. She's had children. I think she's American.
Well, God bless her, and she's making good choices. I always tell women, if you can, marry a billionaire, right? Marry
it's a good move.
Marry a wealthy dude.
Hang in there for a couple of years.
The
and it's
best
way better
life
than working at
is
Amazon.
To marry someone who they make money by destroying themselves while you enjoy it, which is many relationships that I know. A woman will enjoy the fruits of a man's labor. He will destroy himself, and she will kind of enjoy the money.
Right. Well, Bezos, I believe, is retired.
Well,
he stepped down as a CEO,
but it's
right?
kind of like Putin, right? Where they never really stepped down.
Interesting.
But my thing is, like, when you have a country that's this silly,
yeah.
where comedy specials are people coming out making serious points, you have late night hosts crying, you have, you know, the girl who threatened her mother on Dr. Phil is a legitimate star. Right? Bad baby. Remember
right.
that woman?
Oh, yeah.
She threatened to kill her mother on TV. She's a star now.
She has massive Instagram following.
Massive, massive. Where does this go? Right? Pictures of apes are selling for the cost of a Lamborghini. Our last president was the guy who hosted The Apprentice. And on his last day of office, a mob of lunatics ran into the Capitol to take selfies with fucking wigs on. It looked like a sketch I would do. Like, it really is, we're in like a fucking weird movie.
Do you remember when you were a kid and you would hear about the last days of the Roman Empire?
Yes.
Where they were just like eating till they couldn't take anymore and then shoving a feather in their mouth and throwing up and fucking everybody?
Yes.
That's us.
And it's, this when explained like that, it sounds good. It
sounds
doesn't
like a party.
Sound that bad. But it is funny as a comedian when you step back and you go like, this is really, really crazy stuff.
It's crazy stuff, and the problem is I don't see a good ending, because if we fall in, the other problem is we have to compete with China, and China has this amazing ability to control their population through propaganda and intimidation and, you know, total censorship, which we're like moving in that kind of general direction,
right?
Which is really scary, because the one way we may be able to compete with China is to become more like China, because otherwise, like, they're so integrated. their government and their business is inexorable. They're connected. You cannot have a corporation where the government's not involved.
Right.
So the government makes decisions with the corporations that benefit the government, benefit the Chinese Communist Party, benefit the country in general.
And we're on that path, too.
Yeah,
with military, like, industrial contractors, pharma companies that kind of killed the Obama health care bill. They went in and rewrote that. And they were like, we don't want this. All their lobbyists had a lot of influence on that. It's strange to really conceive of it as a reality, as opposed to just a joke or a, kind of a cynical aside. It actually does seem that we're in a stage of decline that's somewhat irreversible.
Yeah,
and
it does.
It's hard not to be depressed.
Have you, I think we've talked about this before, Douglas Murray. He talked about all
the
gender issues.
Yes.
Well, he was on my podcast and he was saying that these gender issues where people are changing genders, swapping genders, he goes, that takes place in all civilizations that are collapsing.
Now, why is that?
I don't know.
Is it people just get bored?
I think it's when life gets very easy, people start looking for problems and they start looking to the structure of society and then looking to try to sort of dissolve. Yeah.
Because there are legitimate trans people, clearly.
Clearly.
Clearly, I know somebody who's trans who never speaks about it, lives as a woman, doesn't even know that I know. Great person. Born a man, now lives as a woman. Lives as a woman, doesn't speak about, is like,
well, say
very
her
much,
name so everybody knows.
Well, I don't, she probably wouldn't even mind. Everyone now is such a fame whore.
Well, I had Blair White on the podcast.
Blair White,
who's as trans as you can get.
As
like,
trans,
you look at that and go, oh, I get it.
So there's
100%.
Legit, but then there's this other thing where people are going, I have green hair.
Yeah.
I'm trans or non-binary. And you go, wait a minute. Hold on a minute. You're a white female who goes to Wesleyan College. You're dating a guy.
Right.
You're in a heterosexual relationship. You've felt no oppression your entire life. Your dad works for Raytheon. Your mother's a pill addict. You go to school and you go.
This is a Billy Joel song.
This is a. You go to school and you figure out a way to not be the oppressor.
Right, right, right.
You go, I will be different now.
Yeah, it's true.
And as a real faggot, you used to have to be a faggot to be a faggot. Like, you used to have sex with men.
Right.
Or if you're a woman, you have sex with women. And people were supposed to, you know, be like, ugh. And there was some naturalness to that because, like, the reaction of people was that the thing that you were saying was real, right? It, and some people were like, it was harder for them to get behind. And
but you suffered legitimate oppression.
You suffered legitimate oppression because the feelings you had were valid and real.
Right, not non-binary oppression.
Yeah, it was real. Like you were saying, I put a penis in my mouth and people were going, that's odd. And well, it was my father said that because that's odd. No, I'm kidding. He's fine with everything as long as he doesn't have to work harder. He's not a hard worker. But he so the whole thing is this new thing has taken over the gay thing now.
Yeah.
So it's not really gay people.
Right. It's fake.
Gay people are kind of looked at as Nazis.
Really.
If you see two lesbians now, because lesbians usually own businesses. You know, they're capitalists. Most lesbians are capitalists, and they're quite vicious.
Really?
They fire people. Oh, most lesbians are very competent people, whereas a lot of gay men.
Like Ellen.
Ellen is a CEO, truly.
Yes.
She has a real estate portfolio that's in excess of $100 million. I mean,
the woman
was a tyrant,
yeah.
But she got things done.
Yeah.
But now I think the gays and lesbians are like the normies of gays now, and there's a new crop of people coming in that don't really have any sex. They spend most of their time online. They're all like pansexual communist witches, and their main goal is to tweet about you. No one even fucks. They're really just tweeting about you. No one's even having dirty, sweaty, sinful sex in a motel room anymore. Everybody's on Reddit talking about you.
Have you?
It's a weird thing.
It's weird for me.
Remember the Birdcage, the movie? It was very fun.
Yeah, I never watched it.
But it's great. Nichols and May wrote it. It's brilliantly funny. It's gay people in South Beach doing drugs, having sex, and having fun. We are like the opposite of that. Mm. We are like in some sexless, autistic horror hellscape where people just sit around and there's this weird, like, office politics, bureaucratic, like, you know, weird, like, you know, you made me upset. You made me upset. Like, I grew up with Rent, where it was that show where people were like, we have AIDS, but let's have fun.
Right, let's dance.
That was the theme of Rent. It was like, we have AIDS, but let's not let it ruin the night.
Yeah.
And now people are just upset for all kinds of reasons. It's weird. And you don't really hate gay people.
No, I don't hate any. Oh, I love you.
Yes,
I don't hate anybody.
You've been very good to me.
Yeah, I don't.
Loving me is like golfing with Candace Owens and going, I love blacks.
No, I love everybody, man. I have no ill will towards any individual group.
Right.
Individual people.
Yeah, of course.
And silly people.
How weird is it that comedy's gotten weird? Like, now at the comedy store, you have all these guys that have talked shit about you, right? Now, obviously, many of them are feeble and diabetic and dying, so it's not like they present a physical threat. I mean, many of them are not well. But if you were, like, is it weird now with this community the way it is that's so splintered?
Well, I don't know who's talking shit about me. And the ones that do, if that is real, I left. And I left, I brought a lot of the people here.
Yeah,
and
right.
It's better here.
Right, right.
You know, and I think there's a lot of FOMO going on for sure.
Yeah.
But then there's also a lot of people that are trying to establish this new position on the food chain, which is one of the ways that you and I became friends.
Right.
Because I read the thing you wrote about Louis.
Right.
And I'm like, he fucking nailed it, because that's exactly what it is.
It's these
mediocre talents
that
are looking to attack Louis, who was at the time, and still is, one of the best comics that's ever lived.
One of the most brilliant comic minds that have ever lived.
And so when they were attacking
attacking him, they weren't just attacking him because they thought that what he did was wrong.
Right.
They were doing it because they wanted to establish that.
Yeah.
They want to stomp him down because he was weakened.
They didn't even know what he did.
Yeah.
You know, like there was just this idea, this very kind of vague general idea of what had been out there and things like that.
There's a lot of cowardice in comedy, man.
Yeah.
There's a lot of cowards. And there's a lot of people that take some chances, but then they fucking think about them and they panic. And then they go back and they'll try to attack someone because they think it makes them feel like they're more protected because they're on the offensive. It's like, it's a wild time, man.
Does it really make sense that the same company who controls half of online retail also passively eavesdrops on all your private conversations at home? What about the idea that a single company controls 90% of internet searches, runs your email service, and gets to track everything you do on your smartphone? Big tech is more powerful than most countries are, and they profit by exploiting your personal data. It's time to put a layer of protection between your online activity and these tech juggernauts, and that's why I use ExpressVPN. Think about how much of your life is on the internet. Sadly, every site you visit, video you watch, message you send gets tracked and data mined. But when you run ExpressVPN on your device, the software hides your current IP address, something big tech can use to potentially identify you. So ExpressVPN makes your activity harder to trace and sell to advertisers. ExpressVPN also encrypts 100% of your internet data to keep you safe from hackers and eavesdroppers on your network. ExpressVPN does all this without slowing your connection. That's why it's rated number one VPN service by Mashable, TechRadar. What I like most about ExpressVPN is how easy it is to use. Download the app on your phone or computer, tap one button, and you're protected. Stop handing over your personal data to big tech monopolies that mine your activity and sell your information. Protect yourself with the VPN I trust to keep me safe online. Visit expressvpn.com/Tim Dillon. That's expressvpn.com/Tim Dillon to get 3 extra months free. expressvpn.com/Tim Dillon right now to learn more. You're going to want the privacy. You're going to want the privacy. You're going to want it. You're going to need it. ExpressVPN. Privacy, it's a private thing. Your life is private when you use this shit. The NFL playoffs are here, and DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NFL, is kicking things off with a huge offer. Counting down to Super Bowl 56, new customers can get 56-1 odds on any wildcard team to win their game. Bet just $5 and win $280 in free bets if your team is victorious. If Sportsbook isn't available in your state yet, you still have something to play for this wildcard weekend. Everyone can play for huge cash prizes with DraftKings Daily Fantasy Football Contest. DraftKings is giving all new customers a free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes with their first deposit. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now. Use promo code Tim Dillon and get 56-1 odds on any NFL team. Bet just $5 and win $280 in free bets. If your team wins, that's promo code Tim Dillon this wild card weekend at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the NFL and a supporter of the Tim Dillon Show. Must be 21 or older. New Jersey, Indiana, or Pennsylvania only. New customers only. Minimum $5 deposit and $1 wager required. One per customer. Restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com/sportsbook for details. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
Social media has flamed up everybody's mental illness. Like anybody who had a little bit of mental illness, they just fucking threw buckets of lighter fluid on that shit.
Would you have Fauci on the show? 100%. Wow.
100%.
You don't think he'd come on though, right?
I don't think he'd come on, but if he did, I would request a real podcast. Like you can't come on for 20 minutes. Like we're going to talk for a few hours.
What if he came here, sat down, got high, and was the greatest guest you've
That'd
ever had?
That'd be awesome.
What if he just admitted it? What if he's like, Joe, we're making
fucking
money.
Let me tell you what I did about AIDS.
Yeah. He goes, we're making money. We made money off AIDS. We made money off this.
I've got he's to like, the point. Yeah. I'm coming clean. I'm 80. What the fuck?
Yeah. He goes, who gives a fuck? You jab him up. A couple of them fall down in a Walmart.
You are
Who cares?
Entirely correct, Tim. That is exactly what I've been doing my entire career.
Yeah. It's a
He's
let me tell you about repurposing HIV drugs. This was how we started the scam.
Gain of function research.
He just
Obama shut it down, right?
Yeah, 2014.
Obama shut down gain of function research.
Yeah.
And he was like wary of the implications of 100%
because he's fucking smart.
He's a smart guy.
You know, how bad do you miss him? When you look at the presidents we've had since
I still do coke with him, so I don't miss him at all.
I would like to.
I do coke with him and his wife in Miami,
but I would
and
like
they're
to
hilarious.
Coke with him and Bruce Springsteen. Together.
Bruce is a depressing.
Because they have a bad podcast. I'd like to come in and spice it up.
Oh, Bruce has a podcast?
With Obama.
No, he doesn't.
It's terrible.
That is
you
horrible.
You and I should go on and show them how to do it. Like, stop.
Yeah.
Like, you know how they get, like, dance instructors that do, like, Dancing with the Stars?
Yes.
They think they're dancers.
Yes,
you know,
right.
Like, oh, I'm a dancer. No. The real dancers are going to show you how to dance.
Yeah.
You and I
should go
them how to fucking podcast.
What the hell are those two talking about?
Nonsense.
Oh, God.
It's nonsense. It's all, like, so, like, it's so aware
of
that
what
people are
doing.
Paying attention.
Yeah.
They're so aware of like walking that line of acceptable narratives that nobody cares about it.
Right.
It doesn't work.
It's crazy.
It doesn't work. That's one thing about podcasts. The brilliant thing about it is because there's no real production and there's no real engineering and where a bunch of people are like writing scripts and following that is that it's so raw that anything that's not like that doesn't work. Whereas like mainstream news is so produced that if you had raw on mainstream news, people are like, what the fuck kind of unprofessional shit is this?
Like Bruce Springsteen's got to turn around to Obama during it and be like, so your wife's a man. Like someone has to, liven it up with fun stuff like that, which isn't true, but it's a fun way.
It's a weird one that
to
the,
kick
that's
off
a QAnon one, you know. They believe that.
They do believe that. They're hardcore.
There's even
videos. Do you ever get people that are with you on the vax but then want you to go much further?
Oh yeah.
They're like, listen,
The world's flat.
Yeah, they don't stop at the vax.
No.
They
Why
go
would you?
Much further.
Why would you? When you go Hollow Earth.
They go Hollow Earth, they go the world is flat.
Reptile people.
Yeah, the Jews are in the cupboard. It's a whole thing. Yeah,
the Great Reset.
Yeah.
Who knows what's real and what's not real?
You know,
you go down the list of all the things that Alex Jones predicted.
Right.
He didn't get a lot of them wrong.
Well, he did it, but he did get a few of them wrong. He
fucked up that Sandy Hook one.
One rhymes with Mandy Mook. And that's a rough one.
That's the problem one. If that one didn't exist.
That's a bad one.
Let's pretend that he never fucked that up. Because he was going through a rough time in his life.
He was going through a rough time.
He was drinking like crazy. He had essentially a psychotic break. I mean, he's really open about it.
But my uncle went through a rough time and he just played golf through it. Like sometimes
he didn't
have
a podcast.
Sometimes you just, that's a great point. But sometimes you just got to go through the rough time without accusing kids of faking their death.
Well, he wasn't accusing the kids of doing it. He was
accusing the parents. Whatever.
He fucked up.
He's a good man.
The point is, if you just remove that and then you look at all the things that he predicted that
he
are
was
accurate,
right about a lot of them.
You got to look at a guy like people are like, why would you talk to a guy like that?
Yeah.
Because first of all, I've known him for more than 20 years. He's my friend. He is a very nice guy.
Right.
He absolutely fucked up, but he'll tell you that he fucked up.
Right.
And people fuck up. And I think you got to be allowed to fuck up.
He did not direct the people to do the horrible things.
No, but
these
the problem
are just
is,
crazy. His fans are crazy.
People
Some
are crazy.
Of his fans are what they call, they're a little off.
I got news for you, pal. Some of yours are off, too.
Mine as well. I know it.
Yeah.
I know it.
No avoiding that. But the idea that you're responsible for the off people that listen to you and want to start screaming at Meghan McCain, stop fucking your dead dad.
Well, that I tell them to do. I organize that. I have rallies.
But
you know what I'm
saying? It's
for
like
sure.
People are crazy. And if you put
I said they wanted to find a conservative on The View. I said, let me go in there with the wig. I'll be the conservative that left.
Does any woman even want to do that anymore?
Nobody wants to do it anymore. Kat Timpf, who was a libertarian on Fox, they were trying to go hard at her. But she's like, I'm on Gutfeld. I'm on a show people watch. Who cares?
They've turned that show into, what they've done is they've made it so that all they do is fight.
Right.
All they do is scream and yell. All they do is get upset at people. It's all negative. It's all demeaning.
Yeah.
It's all insulting.
Yeah.
They've just gotten to this point where the show has just got this feel of it. You only watch to see who they're mad at. Like,
right.
Whoa.
No, it's a horrible, horrible experience for anyone watching or participating in it, truly.
This is what's wrong with it. If you got five friends that just wanted to talk about things like that and they didn't have time limits, and they didn't have, like, all these constraints that are put on a show like that hinder the possibility of it being good. You know, there's
for sure.
All the people in the audience, that's a problem because you're playing to the audience.
Yeah.
And then you have the fact that you have a commercial coming up at 45 seconds. You got to make your point.
Yeah.
And then these other bitches are trying to chime in. You got to talk over them.
But they can't find a female conservative.
No.
I think they're going to have to use that grandma who was yelling at the Sandy Hook parents. I forget her name. The one who was like, prove it, you dumb fuck. But she was a QAnon grandma. I forget her name. Ben knows her name.
QAnon grandma?
Yeah, she was this grandma that was in that documentary, and she would yell at these parents. It was very sad. She'd be like, prove it, you dumb fuck, about their kids dying. And I think she should be on The View. Or get Rosie O'Donnell back, because she at least questioned 9/11.
Yeah. Yeah. She questioned Tower 7 and a lot of other things. Like, there's a... Those things are like real complicated. You can't get those wrong.
You can't get them wrong.
Yeah.
But there's clearly fuckery with that.
Yeah.
If there's fuckery with the vaccine, there's fuckery with that.
Well, there's certainly fuckery in the reaction to that because we invaded Iraq. That's all you need to know. Like, I had a whole bit
for
about
sure.
that at one point.
Yeah.
It's like, if you can look at what happened on September 11, 2001, and then the logical conclusion is we got to invade a country that had nothing to do with it.
It's crazy. It's like, it's crazy.
And then they did it. And they said, well, there's weapons of mass destruction there. Okay.
Yeah.
And they cost like more than a million lives. And it turns out there were no weapons of mass destruction.
It's just a weird thing where I go, I'm just like one of those old school guys that goes, just show me one video of the plane hitting the Pentagon, and I'm good.
See, I think it's a video of the plane hitting the Pentagon.
No, there's not.
It looks like a fucking plane.
It's
what does
not.
That look like?
It's a trail of smoke. They doctored it. 9/11, the
you
new
think
Pearl
they doctored
Harbor.
It?
9/11, the new Pearl Harbor is a crazy documentary by this Italian guy, Massimo Mazzucco. It's 5 hours. Watch it. You people have nothing to do. It's 5 hours.
Is it good?
It's great. I'm telling you right now, it's a 5-hour documentary on YouTube. You will watch it, get the fam together, sit them down, popcorn. And I'm telling you right now, because I watched it to debunk it. I watched it to debunk it and went, yeah, you start going into the phones at 30,000 feet. These people are having conversation. It's just not happening.
That's
something's
true.
Off.
You can't have
something's
a cell
really
phone
off.
Call at 30,000 feet.
Something's really, really off with that day. But you just can't. Now in these publications that write about me, they describe me as like 9/11 truther. COVID denier. It's like, I just get all these.
You had COVID. How can you be a denier?
I've never said COVID was not real.
Yeah.
You know, I've said I thought it was good.
Well, I've had people mad at me because I medicated, because I took medicine.
Well, people's argument is you're in shape, you eat right, you work out. Why would you take the medications?
Because it's better than not taking medication.
Of course.
Like that stuff works.
Like, of course.
Listen, I'm not saying you shouldn't take medication. I'm saying...
Right. You're saying you should take medication.
I'm saying you should, for sure, always. But especially if it's proven medication that works.
Yeah.
But the point is, like, you shouldn't have a binary solution for things. So it's either this or nothing.
Right.
Like, it's either one or zero. Like,
right.
That's crazy.
Do you, when people pass away, they donate a large chunk of their fortune to like research and things like that. Do you think you'll donate yours to Robert F. Kennedy Jr. or like Dana White? Who will you give your money to?
Demi Lovato. She's gonna give it to ghosts.
Hey man, she used to live in my building. Fun woman. Yeah, it's straight. Do you ever think to yourself, what's the next act? Because you're the most successful comedian, probably, when you look at all the different things you've done. There's not many people that have, like, what do you ever go, I've done it all, and that's a little scary?
No, because I don't think like that ever. The crazy thing about all the different things that I've done is all I've ever tried to do, like I tried to become a professional comedian. I achieved that, and then I started working as a professional comic, and then all the other stuff is just stuff that came up.
Right.
Whether it's acting on news radio, that was just, they just offered me money to
do
act.
Do you still
this.
Keep in touch with Kathy Griffin?
No, I would though.
No, yeah. It's...
I love her.
Yeah. Was she on that show or no?
No.
Okay, I thought she was on that show.
No. Kathy Griffin was on Just Shoot Me, right?
It was the other one. I forgot.
Yeah. She's nice.
Yeah.
Vicki Lewis was on news radio. That's who you're thinking of.
Yeah, okay. I don't know about her.
She's redhead too.
I'm getting confused.
We used to always joke around that she was stealing her act.
Oh,
like,
interesting.
When we were on news radio.
Yeah.
Joking around.
And, and you worked with Phil Hartman, who was like one of the funniest people ever.
But again, that was just like I stumbled into that show.
Right.
Like completely stumbled into it. I had no acting experience.
Right.
I mean, I'd done a little bit of acting on another terrible sitcom that got canceled. That got canceled. All of a sudden, I'm on news radio working with Dave Foley and Andy Dick and Phil Hartman with no acting experience. I'm like, what the fuck is happening
here? Yeah, what's going on?
And then I go from that to Fear Factor. I'm like, well, this will get canceled immediately. Meanwhile, it's one of the most successful reality shows ever. It's like six seasons.
What did you learn from like that? Was it just do everything and don't focus too much on like... Because there's even though you're saying you're stumbling into them, and you are stumbling into them, there's a skill to stumbling, right? There's a skill to being, positioning yourself in a way that you can kind of get those opportunities.
There's that, but there's also being able to handle pressure.
Okay, there
like
you go.
Like being able to handle auditions, pressure, being able to handle the pressure of speaking live in front of a large audience, whether it's doing the UFC broadcast or doing a comedy show or a podcast. You gotta be able to handle pressure.
Right.
Some people just suck at pressure. You know, and
that's
I've always put myself in these positions where I have to perform under pressure because opportunities are available there because so many people don't like pressure.
Right.
So I would look at it and go, oh, they're scared. People are scared of this, so I'll go do that.
Right.
Like, there's less people doing it, and it's more exciting to me because it's kind of dangerous
when,
and scary.
When you got into it, was your family like, oh, this is cool, or were they like, no, what are you doing?
What are you doing, idiot?
Yeah.
Like, go to school. Get a career.
Right.
Get a real job. Like, you're not funny.
Right.
Like, there was a lot of that.
Right.
When I was fighting, like, you're going to get hurt.
Yeah.
You know, there's, like, everything I've done, like, what are you doing? You know, it's just, it's hard. If you have a child and you want your child to be successful, you don't want your child to take some wild, crazy fucking chance that what is a 1,000,000-to-1 chance it's going to pan out? Probably more than 1,000,000-to-1.
Right. Was your childhood like the show Cobra Kai on Netflix where you're just fighting people all the time? Mm-mm. That's what I imagine it is. You're just, you're in a dojo, you have a sensei, you just fight the other kids at the you know, prom.
Well, I did fight a lot of people, but I did it mostly in tournaments, but I did fight in dojos a lot. We
did
had
you ever
real
kill
dojo
anyone?
Fights. Not that I know of.
Okay. Why were you fighting everybody? Were they fighting you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We like guys would come in from other schools and they
to
would
file,
want to challenge us. And I was often the guy who got thrown in with them.
Yeah. When you were younger, were you bullied? What motivated you?
Yeah. I was small, and guys would pick on me, and I moved around a lot. Like, we moved all the time. Like, I lived in San Francisco from New Jersey to age 7, San Francisco age 7 to 11, Florida 11 to 13, Boston 13 to 24. So I was fucking moving constantly.
Right.
So I never really established a great group of friends that I was tight with.
Right.
I was always the new kid, and I was not big, so I got fucked with.
Right. So you learned to defend yourself.
Well, I had to. When I moved to to Newton, I got fucked with like by a bunch of kids, and it was kind of scary. You know, I didn't know how to defend myself, and I was like, "Fuck! Like, I got to do something." And so I started taking martial arts, and it changed my life 180 degrees. Like, rah! Turned it around 180 degrees.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, I wasn't worried about conflict anymore, and then I became obsessed with being like. Oh, like a world champion. I became obsessed with being like
did you have
the
like one good teacher where there's a few good teachers that stand out?
Yeah. I had quite a few, but I got very lucky that I went to this one school, this Jaehyun Kim Taekwondo Institute in Boston. That's like one of the most highly respected schools in the country, at the time at least. And it was just dead lucky. Just dead luck. I just happened to go there one day.
Right.
And I happened to go there while this guy, John Lee, was training for the world championships. And I happened to watch him train like when he was at his peak of condition, when he was a national champ. And I became obsessed. And
right.
And I was there every day.
Right.
So most of my high school from like age 15 all the way until I was 21 was just obsessed with martial arts and competing.
Right.
Traveling all over the country. That's mostly what I did.
And your friends, I guess, were people in that world.
Yes.
Yeah.
Some of them, like my friend Steve Graham, I'm still really tight with.
Yeah. And what makes you go from that to comedy?
Well,
it's kind of an interesting transition.
Fear of brain damage. There was a little bit of that because I was definitely aware that I was getting hit in the head too much. That was especially when I started kickboxing. I had three kickboxing fights. And when I was training for kickboxing, which I did for more than a year, there was a lot of getting hit in the head. There was a lot of hard sparring rounds. And then I was also watching a lot of other people that I saw that had brain damage. I was like, ugh. Like, this guy's not who he used to be. Like, he's slipping. And then I realized, like, oh, my God, this is happening to me. And there was no money in it.
Right.
There was no UFC back then. So this is 1988, 89. Is when
so you're like, you got to get out.
Yeah, I had to get out.
Yeah.
And I had to get out soon before I ruined my brain, you know. And then
Also, fortunately, my friend Steve that I was talking about earlier, he was one of the people that told me I should be a comedian. Because I would, we would go on these trips to go to fight in tournaments, right?
Right.
Oftentimes we'd be on a bus or we'd travel by car together and we'd be bored and I would be the one who made everybody laugh. And so like if we were like getting ready to spar, everybody would be super nervous and I would say the most inappropriate shit
right.
and get laughs out of people. And once I knew that I could get laughs, then I would just try to do it.
Right.
Like whenever I knew people were nervous, I would say the inappropriate thing or I'd do impressions of people or impressions of like our instructor having sex.
Right. So you just established yourself as kind of the funny dude.
I was silly.
Yeah.
I would
silly
be silly.
And funny.
And it would like it was gallows humor, right? Because everyone was so scared. And it was also it would alleviate some of the pressure of like getting scared before you go to a tournament.
Right.
We're all scared.
Right.
You know, and so my friend Steve said, you really should be a fucking comedian.
Yeah.
And I go, ah, man, you think I'm funny because you like me. I go, other people are going to think I'm an asshole.
Right.
And he's like, you should just go and just see an open mic night and try it. And so I did. I went to an open mic night. And
were you hooked on night one?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Richard Jenny had a great point.
Yeah.
He goes, horrible comedians are amazing in that they inspire people to try it. Because you look at someone who's terrible and you go, well, I can't be as bad as that guy.
Right.
I'll give it a shot.
Right.
And that's what open mic night was to me.
Right.
Because I had thought of stand-up like Jerry Seinfeld or Richard Pryor. I thought, like, I can't do that. These guys are too good.
Right.
But then you go to open mic night and you go, oh, some of these people are terrible.
Right.
And they're doing it. And, like, I can kind of do it like they're doing it, maybe a little better than them. Maybe I could do this. And then on the same night, like there was like Jonathan Katz was the host of the open mic night from Dr. Katz
in Boston. Yeah.
He was the host of open mic night the first time I ever went on stage. And then on that night, some other real professionals went on, like Teddy Bergeron went on.
Yeah.
And I got to see him go on and I got hooked immediately.
Yeah.
So I did my first set and then I almost chickened out. I got really close to chickening out. Oh my God. I came that close to pussying out.
Yeah.
And then once I did it, I was hooked. And then I started doing it all the time.
And you got successful pretty quick.
Pretty quick, yeah. I mean, luckily in Boston, you could get work pretty quick.
Right.
You know, so like within 1 year of doing open mic nights and, you know, and Fitzsimmons and I started out together and Greg and I would drive together to Rhode Island to do 10 minutes.
Right.
So we'd drive 90 minutes, do 10 minutes.
What year was that?
88.
Wow.
Yeah.
We
both started in 88. We both started with like within a week of each other.
So you would go to comedy, everybody smoking cigarettes.
Oh, yeah.
It was the old, you know, old school.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Bars were filled
Night
with
at the
cigarette
improv
smokes.
Comedy.
Oh,
yeah.
There was no idea, like, there was no non-smoking.
Right. Yeah, it was
every
hilarious.
Bar had
just
smoked
everything
it.
Smoked.
Everything
smelled
smoked
like that. Yeah.
And
yeah.
everyone smoked.
Right.
It was crazy.
And people just, you would go up, do the 10 minutes,
yeah.
sink or swim,
yep.
killer bomb, and then you would be back on the road.
Yep. And then we would try to go to different places. Like, we would go to a couple different spots a night if we could. You know, sometimes we knew another guy who had another room. So
did you know
here.
Back then, would you look at certain people and go, that guy's going to make it?
A lot of people I thought were going to make it that didn't.
And what do you attribute a lot of that to? Why do you think a lot of funny people, because I've seen that now, I've been doing it about 11 years, probably almost 12 years now. A lot of people, I was like, that person was really funny.
Yeah.
And they didn't get to that next level.
I don't know, man.
Yeah.
I don't. I mean, I think there's
a lot
a bunch
of it is
of factors.
Drinking.
Yeah, that's one.
A little too drugs. Much sometimes. Drinking or drugs.
That could be it, but it's also there's psychology involved.
Like, yeah.
The mind games that the unknown and the uncertain play on people. Sometimes people just crack.
That's
they just
right.
can't take it anymore. Just like we were talking about fame.
Yeah.
People crack under fame. Like, they get to a certain point where they can't handle this anymore.
They can't
they
handle
crack.
It. They don't know what's real.
Right. They crack
right.
under that. They crack under the pressure of not knowing if they're going to make it. I mean, I've seen that in actors, too. Like, I've been friends with actors that were like, they'd get on a show, and then, you know, they'd audition for another show, and then maybe not make it, but maybe have, like, another callback for the thing, and they're always in flux. And they would go crazy because they didn't know, like, what am I doing with my life? What is happening? Is this going to work out? And they'd start crying
right.
and freaking out. It's like
right.
just the uncertainty and the unknown. For some people, it's just too much.
It's
and
too much.
Some of them are really fucking talented.
Some of them are really funny. And then there's a lot of people that are somewhat mediocre, but they have mastered the unknown.
Yeah,
like that's
well, there's delusional.
Yeah, there's crazy people out there that that can channel that into certitude.
Yeah,
and then they start convincing themselves, like they've convinced themselves they're great,
And then they start convincing everyone else, and it's kind of like the emperor has no clothes, where everyone's like, I guess they're great.
Well, I don't even know about that, but one thing that some mediocre people do is they're not funny at all, but they've managed to stay around.
Right.
Like, here they are, 10 years later, 15 yeah. years later, he's right. still here. He's yeah. still going up, hosting that show at the, you know,
still
whatever.
Doing it. Yeah. Still doing it. Yeah. yeah. Do
it's
you
weird.
Do you think people that are starting comedy now are, is it going to be a completely different world? Where I tend to think now people that are starting are going to have to go to the internet. And almost the same way that you were taking a beating at open mics and things like that, they're almost going to have to take a beating online in front of a digital audience to build their thing, because the mainstream or the legacy industry seems to of comedy seems to be dying. So even though they'll
that.
Be getting good at stand-up on the side, if they don't have other components.
What do you mean by the mainstream of comedy's dying?
Meaning that the idea of moving to New York or LA and doing 20 sets a week and then getting the Montreal Comedy Festival and then getting the booker at the club to see you and like you and then getting a special on HBO, all that seems to be dying. I know so many people with hour specials and nobody's watching them, right? Or so many people with late night TV shows, like they're hosting them and no one cares.
Yeah, that's true.
And they're not making that much money. And it seems to be a smaller and smaller circle of people that this is mattering to. Every day the internet's expanding, it seems to be getting bigger and bigger, and the people that have a platform online, a digital platform, seem to be getting more and more attention. So to me, isn't there an inevitable shift coming to where comics really are just going to have to compete digitally?
I think the digital aspect of it is the best way to promote themselves, for sure.
Right.
Whether it's through putting their stuff online on a YouTube or a Rumble or Instagram or whatever they're doing.
Like, or people, Getter, which you're now Getter. On. You're yeah. on Getter. That's a news story.
Might
like,
be a
why
part of the
is it a news
Chinese
story?
Communist Party now, I believe.
Yeah. Why are you? It's a news story that you're on Getter.
Well, the news story is their fucking amount of people that signed up increased by 1,150% or something.
Yeah,
something
you have bananas. Like 20. You have like 8-9 million followers on Getter.
Yeah, it's not real though.
Is it
because
not real?
Getter doesn't even have 9 million people. No,
really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's very. It's a lot
so
of fuckery.
So there's fuckery with that.
This is where the fuckery is. They
yeah.
take all my Twitter followers. So my Twitter followers like 7.8 million.
Yeah.
And then they port those over. So I started out with 7.8
oh.
million. So whatever I have now, if I have 8, it's like really I have 200,000.
So Getter
yeah.
is fugazi.
Fugazi.
As they say.
Definitely
right.
fugazi. And every time I post on Twitter, it posts automatically on Getter.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, like it's automatically
weird.
Does that.
So it's just harvesting your
yeah.
tweets.
And I don't know how to get off. Like if I get off of Getter,
you
I don't
have
know.
To you have
I think
to
I can.
You have to sit down with Marjorie Taylor Greene
yes.
personally.
And she's gotta tell me all
yeah.
about what's in the basement
yeah,
of Comet Pizza.
She's gotta take you down the rabbit hole, then you come out the other side of Getter. But yeah, it seems to me that like the business is kind of dying.
I don't think it is.
You don't think it is?
No, I disagree.
You
I think
prove it is.
This is no. That aspect of the business, as far as like Montreal Comedy Festival and stuff like that being beneficial, that's true. That's dying.
Right.
But podcasts have taken their place.
Right.
And
okay.
comedians now, like Brian Simpson, who's got his new
Brilliant.
Netflix
one
special.
Of the best.
Yeah, he's
yeah.
working with me this weekend at
he's
Vulcan.
He's one of the best.
I love him to death. And he, now that he has this huge Netflix special that killed, and he's been on my podcast a couple of times, he's got a career.
Right.
Like, he's killing it.
Right.
And he will continue to kill it.
Yeah.
So this is where the
But
the
he's not as big
gone.
As Ranbu. So my point is that
who's that? What is
Ranbu's a Minecraft streamer, Joe. Stop pretending you don't know who he is.
Is that real?
Yeah, he's a Minecraft streamer. My point is that things are moving quickly.
But we can't compare ourselves to Minecraft streamers.
I understand that, but I'm just saying, yes, we can.
I was in the new bookstore the other day, and Dr. Disrespect has a book.
Mr. Beast has a burger.
Well, Mr. Beast deserves a burger.
He's a brilliant guy.
He's got a great
Is it
show.
Good?
It's a great show.
Yeah, he does
a great
he's
show.
A visionary
it's,
guy.
It's a smart thing that he does. He spends a shitload of money on his show.
Well, that's what I mean. These are the
yes.
new stars.
Well, that's just
These
in that
new,
world, but those are the new stars yeah. in terms of like, that would be, he would be a reality TV star
like 10 years ago.
For sure.
Now he's a YouTube star, but now he's his own fucking boss and he's doing it the right way, which is why it's so successful. The same thing with your podcast. Imagine a world where an executive bankrolls your podcast and says, oh, are you going to sit together with your friend Ben and you're going to wear cop sunglasses and you're going to talk shit about the whole world?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? Yes. You want me to pay for that?
I could think of several executives that would fund it, but they're all disgraced. Angelo Mozzillo at Country Ride. Dick Fold at Lehman Brothers.
Exactly.
But yeah, this is no, my for point. Sure.
It's
yeah.
like the world has changed, but there are new avenues that are available.
Right.
But the world of comedy remains in clubs. Like you
yes,
must.
That is true. You got to be able to get on stage and kill.
Right. And we both.
Yeah.
That is the most important. One of the most important things.
Yes.
It's like, I'm not giving that up. Like, stand up is fucking awesome. And
yes.
that is always going to be a thing that I like to see. And it's always going to be a thing that I like to do. And it's always going to be a thing where people want to go see a comic. They want to go live. It's a fun thing to do.
But don't you want to get to the point where people know you so well from the internet that when you get on stage, they just clap for 45 minutes. You don't even have to write material. And then you can just leave. You can kind of wave like Princess Diana used to do.
I don't think that ever happens. I don't think you ever get that.
No, of course not.
I feel the heat after about 15 seconds.
Of course not. No, of course you do. I get nervous as soon as I walk on stage.
Yes.
I get the mic. I go... No, yeah. it's the biggest high you ever have. It's the best thing. It's the best art form.
It's also just, the best thing for the audience. Like in terms of like me as
fun.
An audience member,
yeah.
I love watching someone kill. It's fun.
That's right.
When I laugh hard, like I'm laughing hard at someone killing.
But you're also from a generation of people that leaves their house.
That's true.
There's a whole
There's
generation
a lot
of people that are scared to leave the room,
well,
let alone the house.
My audience
and
dies
they have
of
to
old
be
age,
entertained.
I'll quit.
You have to keep evolving. You should be on Twitch. You should be streaming.
I'm on Spotify.
You're a young
That's
man.
That's my evolution.
You can keep going. Where's my deal? What did they tell us? Fuck off for the ninth time? Or cause
Why
I
are they telling you to fuck
I
off?
I attacked the CEO. I said he was a pedophile. It was a
That's
joke.
That's not real.
No one can have fun anymore.
I think you said I'm a pedophile too.
Yeah. I don't know if I did that, but I said that the CEO... was something or other. But
so he's mad at you?
No, he's not mad, but apparently because they have you, they don't need me.
Yeah.
Because we have overlap, and they're still going by the
old... They should get you.
They're still going by the old numbers that say that this show's bigger than mine. Those are the old numbers.
That's last week.
This show's not even on YouTube anymore. I keep telling them.
It's true.
It's not even on YouTube. They go, oh, no, it doesn't matter. We have the internals, and you're...
Honestly, the beautiful thing about Spotify has been the lack of censorship. And the lack of fear of having episodes pulled and all that shit.
Spotify's been amazing. And in the beginning, people thought they were going to be worse than YouTube. They've actually, conversely, been so much better.
Yeah, there's been so much better. I think that's just because people are always, they hate change. They hate any kind of like new
that's right.
thing that's happening. And, you know, also it's like they hate someone doing well. So if someone gets some
That's
big
right.
crazy deal and they're making all this money, like, oh, it sucks now. I
right.
used to watch. Now I hate it.
Yeah.
It's fucking the
sucks.
Worst.
He sold out.
It's normal. It's normal.
Right.
So, and also, in the beginning, I did lose a lot. We lost like 50% of our audience, like almost right away.
Yeah.
Jamie was in a frothy panic.
Really?
Look at him.
Well, he's got so many other opportunities.
Frothy panic.
Yeah.
But a year later, we've got as much, if not more. We have more
right.
now.
Right.
And it's better. It's bigger than it's ever been.
Yeah.
It just had to like
This
catch
is just
up.
What happens immediately. In
but
the,
I was like, good, let me be 10% less famous.
Right.
I'll be
right.
happy for 25. Give me 25% less fame.
Yeah.
And more money.
Well, that's not the way it's worked out.
Yeah, well,
that's funny that you said
CNN.
That. You're like, let's be a little less controversial, a little less famous.
Yeah, well, I was,
and
like,
then on the other side of it, you have Fauci trying to drone you outside of your house. It
well,
didn't really work
for him now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh my God, that
you
poor
think
guy.
So?
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
people
they're
are
coming,
coming
for him.
He's
they hail
24 security.
Look at the Cuomos.
Yes.
They hail you and nail you like the Cuomos.
Well, that's a different situation.
Right.
But the Fauci situation, after Rand Paul attacked him for gain-of-function research, and then people started looking into gain-of-function
yes.
research, and it all came from Josh Rogan's reporting. And Josh Rogan,
yeah.
he was the one who showed that Fauci funding the EcoHealth Alliance, that the NIH funding them, is what started up gain-of-function research in Wuhan, like after Obama had put the kibosh on it.
Yeah.
And he's like still in denial, but the NIH has come clean. NIH has said, yes, it's gain of function research. And Fauci's like, gain of function research is a very nebulous term. Like, he talks so slow.
Yeah, he gets off to diseases. The guy's a problem.
It's amazing his, like, the way he handles where he's obviously cornered.
Right.
And he just, like, jujitsus his way.
Well, he's also been a government. guy forever.
Forever.
He's been a bureaucrat
the
forever.
The highest paid government employee.
Yeah, and
he's paid more than the president.
Yeah, and they did a documentary about him, and he's very vain.
The documentary about him is the reason they took the thumbs down off of YouTube.
It's crazy how vain, how vain he is.
Of course.
You know, and how, you know, unwilling he is to give up the spotlight, even when, as you showed me that Hugh Hewitt clip, people are like, you know, you might accomplish the goal of getting more people vaccinated by stepping aside.
Yeah.
Because you're not well liked or trusted.
And it's crazy to watch him react to that.
Yeah.
You're crazy.
You're crazy.
I completely disagree.
Yeah. It's my show.
If you criticize Anthony Fauci, yeah, you're criticizing science.
Would you have Billy Boy Gates on?
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
I think that would be interesting.
I'd say, how do I get in the club?
Yeah.
What do I have to do?
Well, it's about that time. You're knocking on that door.
How do I get a yacht?
Dude, what if you just reversed everything you said tomorrow? Like, it would be kind of hilarious.
Turn around.
If you just went in here tomorrow and go, you know, I slept on it. And I've decided.
I got double vaxxed last night.
Yeah, you go, I got double vaxxed last
night. I took both shots at the same time.
I had a great sleep, and I have the CEO of Pfizer and Moderna here and Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
And we're all going to tell you everything's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the move.
Does it scare you to be at the level of prominence you are with, like, a family? Just the idea of, like, as the kids grow up, and they hear things on the news. Is it harder for you to explain to them?
It is what I do.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not easy to explain, but nor would it be easy to explain if I was a hitman. You know,
right.
It's like,
well,
what
those
do you
aren't
do?
The only two options.
That's how I live. I have one or two choices. Either I go out like the Punisher.
Right. I mean, I like that. But so do they ever ask, or are they not?
Yeah, I mean, they think it's funny. Like
right.
But they think it's funny because I think it's funny.
That's right.
Like, when I come home, like, Daddy's in trouble again.
Right.
Oh, the government's right. Mad at Daddy.
Yeah.
You know, like, they don't. If I really tweaked, they would probably tweak too.
But you set that standard of, like, this is part of the job,
part of the gig, man. You know, and, you know, it's that if you can't take the heat expression. You know,
right.
Shouldn't be in this business.
Right. So absolutely.
It's the business of opinions. You know, we're in the business of opinions.
Yeah.
And it's a weird fucking business because it's hard for people to have opinions today because of corporate structures, human resources. You know, you want to make it up the corporate ladder, and there's an ideology that your company has, and if it's left wing or right wing, you have to toe that line. Like, it's fucking hard for people to just have opinions. And even if they do have opinions, when do they have the time to talk about it?
That's right.
The thing about talking about opinions like we do, where you sit and talk for hours and hours, nobody has the time to do that.
What have you learned, I think, through this whole period, not only just the last year, but the last few years, about the way that friendships work at your level? Because everybody wants something from you, right?
Yeah.
You have this platform, you can share it with people, everybody wants to get on the show. Everybody wants maybe you to endorse their. I have friends who call me, they're like, yo, tell Joe about this weed opportunity. I'm like, are you on drugs? And they are, but like, how do you deal with just that? Whereas all these different people.
I have to say no to a lot of things.
You say no to a lot of people.
And sometimes, sometimes it's uncomfortable. Like, sometimes people won't let it go. And, you know.
And you said people will come at you all different ways.
All
friends,
different ways.
Your wife,
friends,
everybody just trying
constantly.
To get in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an issue. You know, I mean, I changed my phone number a lot.
Right.
I've got to change it again, you know.
Right.
I've changed it last year. I got to change it again. And I have several phones. I have four phones now. I used to have three. Now I have four.
That's crazy.
You know, I have A, B, C, and D. You're A. Congratulations.
Oh, congrats. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
You're the phone I carry.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of people that I check that phone once a week.
Right.
Yeah. And maybe not even. Sometimes not
Who's
even.
Who's the best guest you've had other than me in the last 7 or 8 years, would you say?
There's so many good ones, man.
Yeah.
There's
Was
so
there
many.
Anything? I mean,
so many serious ones, so many
funny
ones.
What stands
out
in my head is Peterson.
Yeah.
Classic.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Bob Lazar.
Oh, yeah. That was a great
one. A great episode. You know, I don't know if he's
Mike
full
Tyson.
Of shit or not. Mike Tyson's great.
I've had a lot of great ones, man.
Elon
is always a great
one.
And
Alex.
Yeah, Alex is great.
Yeah.
I've had so many great ones, so many comics. Like, one of the things that we've been doing is me, Shane Gillis, Mark Norman, and Ari Shaffir, we do this thing called the Cuddle Party.
Yeah.
Where the four of us, and we get fucking hammered and
That's
talk
great.
The most shit. And
That's
then
great.
Afterwards, like,
panic, like, maybe we should cut that part out.
Oh, that's
like,
the best. That's when you know it's good. Yeah. That's oh when God. You know an episode is
Gillis
good.
Gillis was hammered.
We've only had one person, and it was Giannis Papas, come on our show where we couldn't use any of it.
Because
he just starts attacking, screaming about Ali Wong. I mean, he's mentally ill. We love him, but he's unwell, and we know
he's
that.
He's had too many heroes.
Yeah, and so we just couldn't use it, but God love him. But those are when you know they're good episodes. Yeah.
Well, it's those, but those with the ones with comics are my favorite because I feel the most at home. I mean, look, I wear a lot of different hats, for lack of a better term, when I do this thing. It's very strange. Like, sometimes I'm talking to a scientist. Sometimes I'm talking to someone who wrote a book about the environment. Sometimes I'm talking to a psychologist. Sometimes I'm talking to a comedian. Sometimes I'm talking to a fighter. Sometimes I'm talking to an inventor. It's like weird. Right. It's a weird gig, man.
Yeah.
And it's only me that's booking them. It's like that guy looks like fun.
How do people get on? People ask me all the time. They go, how does somebody get on that?
I seek people out.
I said, yeah, I think I'm like, he just has to want you to come on.
Yeah, that's it. There's no other way on.
Right.
I have to say yes. Like, there's literally no other way on.
There's also giving me $25,000. And what that'll do is increase the likelihood.
It'll help. Yeah.
But it's not an exact.
I have done that once.
Really?
Yes. I didn't take the money, but he paid a friend. And my friend was broke. And he told me, hey, this guy told me that if I get you on, or if I get him on your podcast, he'll give me $25,000. That was the exact number.
That's crazy.
Funny to that. And I said, listen, I said, I would have that guy on anyway. Because he's really interesting.
Right.
So yes. So you can. I love you. So you take the money.
Yeah.
And then I'll have him on. But I would just let you know. I would have had him on anyway. But don't tell him that and get that money.
Good for you. But yeah, there's no way on. There's just you have to be interested in what somebody is saying.
That's one of the beauties of the podcast is that it's only what I'm interested in. So whether it's talking to Bob Lazar or talking to a fighter or talking to an artist. You know, like Beeple, like it's only, I have to be interested. And I'm like, oh, I'd like to talk to that guy. Or Oliver Stone, who was on today. I was like, Oliver Stone wanted to come on. And I don't know if you've seen his new fucking Kennedy documentary.
It's amazing.
Holy shit.
I haven't seen it, but it's
fucking amazing.
And
there's a
deep.
4-hour one
Where
that's coming
is
out
it?
At the end of, it's on Showtime right now until the end of February. At the end of February, it's everywhere. And he's going to release a 4-hour version.
Wow.
Yeah, it's fucking fantastic.
So this will leave no doubt that it's a coup.
Oh my God, there's no doubt with the 2-hour one, but he says it's even deeper with the 4-hour
one.
But like having Oliver Stone on, like fuck yeah. Quentin Tarantino, fuck yeah. Like those kind of people, it's like, it's just who I'm interested in. Can I talk to that person? Yeah, let's get him. Go get him.
Let's do it. For sure.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why the podcast works is because there's never a moment like, you remember that Bill Hicks bit about Jay Leno? Sitting there talking to Joey Lawrence.
And his blood splatters like the NBC peacock.
Because he's a company
man
to
the
bitter
end. Yeah.
But it's that Jay Leno really didn't want to talk to these guys.
Right.
Like, that's the bit. Like, hey, Joey Lawrence. No, you got a girlfriend? What's going on?
Right,
well, maybe.
Yeah.
You know?
And you talk to people you want to talk to.
Exactly. Like, there's no one gets on unless I'm interested.
And so much of the rage, I think, at you is that you've really found this way to monetize enjoying stuff. And satiating your curiosity and having these long, meaningful conversations. And you've revolutionized the long form discussion.
Yeah.
And all of these other media figures that supposedly could have done it or fancy themselves to be intellectuals and to be, none of them did it. You did it. A comedian, an MMA commentator, you did it. None of them did it.
It's weird.
So I think a lot of the rage at you comes from that. It's that you took a chance on yourself. And it worked out, and none of them did.
Well, it's weird too in that, when it became long form, just because that's what I wanted to do. Like Ari was like the fucking most adamant person telling me, "You gotta change it. You gotta edit it." He would tell me, like, "You know, I'm telling you right now, you're fucking up." I go, "How am I fucking up?" He goes, "You gotta edit your show. It's too long." I go, "Well, then don't listen."
Right. He's when he goes, people won't listen. You go, they don't have to.
Yeah, I'm like, I don't care.
Yeah.
I was making no money.
Right.
I was making $0.
Right.
And I was doing it every week.
Yeah.
And it got to the point where there was one time when me and Red Band were sitting around. He goes, do you know how many downloads this gets? And I go, no. And he goes, the episode got 1 million downloads. And it was like a record skip.
Yeah.
I go, what?
Yeah, where did
that? 1 million downloads? Yeah.
Ari has great advice. He told me once that I should put out a tweet about Kobe Bryant, and I didn't. So thank God. But just so sometimes he is wrong. Sometimes
he's wrong.
Yeah,
he's a funny guy. But he so have you ever seen his dick and balls?
Every day. I let him stay at my rental in Texas.
He sent me this video.
All he does is expose himself indecently.
His balls don't look like they belong with his dick. I told him that his balls seem like his dick is a hermit crab and stole his balls from someone else and they're living inside of it.
He's completely out of his mind.
You're here with me in spirit too. So, happy New Year!
Look at those balls.
It's insane.
They're so big.
It's like elephantitis.
They're like a giant chimp.
Yeah,
like you know, chimps have huge balls.
It's like elephantitis. Yeah, it's crazy.
That's what it's like.
How does a family like Texas?
Love it.
They love it.
Yeah, they love it.
They love it.
Yeah, man, it's fucking great here.
Yeah,
people are so much more relaxed. And what I think is really important than what I'm doing here with the club and the podcast here is I'm completely removing myself from the influence of Hollywood.
Right.
Because when you're in LA, you're still
in it. You're still in it. Yeah.
It's contagious.
Yeah.
It's in the air, and you're like, ew, I got it on me. Like. That disingenuous bullshit for, you know, that fake sort of behavior that they do, that stuff gets into our business.
Yeah.
And we have those actor types that kind of like, they dance in both worlds and they have like one foot in the actor world and one foot in the, and then they'll tweet about stuff.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck are, you doing? Why are you tweeting about that?
Right.
Because they're in these both worlds and that world, it contaminates things.
Right.
And comedy needs to have its own center where it's like comedy is the 100% the thing. It's not comedy to become a sitcom star.
Right.
I want to tell young comics and I want to help them and say, hey, you don't have to do anything else.
Right.
You can just do comedy. You don't have to have anybody hire you for something.
Right.
You can be completely autonomous and you could have all this like freedom to do podcasts, do other people's podcasts, and we all will work together as an organic network.
Yeah.
And you can just practice stand-up.
Right.
Which is what everybody loves.
Right.
Everybody loves stand-up. You do those other things because you think that's what you have to do for a career.
Yeah.
But ultimately, I remember being on news radio, I remember being on Fear Factor in particular, and seeing people that I knew that I started out with that were killing it in theaters, and they were on the road all the time, and I would be jealous.
Right.
And I'd be like, God, I wish I was doing that.
Yeah.
But I was trapped. Not trapped, obviously. It's a good trap.
Yeah.
But I was doing a show, and I was like, I can't travel.
Yeah.
I have this show I have to do all the time.
Yeah.
And I could travel very rarely.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, God, this like cements in my head that I really love stand-up. I love money. It's money. What's nice about money is you don't have to worry about money.
Right.
Because if you don't have money, then you worry about money. But if you can have a clear head, and once you get money, don't think, oh my God, I hope this doesn't go away. Now I have to play everything safe and I have to really play by the rules so I get more of this Hollywood money.
Right.
Instead, what I did was going, okay, good. Now I've got some money. Now I can just be free. Now I'm gonna just do what I want to do.
Yeah.
And then the podcast thing came out of that because it was completely organic. There was no thought whatsoever about it being profitable.
Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah. And the club you're going to open in a few months and then a lot of people will come probably, you know, to the club from other places too.
Well, I hope so.
Because you have a huge fan base and people will come.
The goal is to be as supportive as possible to the stand-up community.
Right.
To make an awesome place where comics, where audiences can come, have a great time. Comics can come and know they're safe.
Right.
We're going to have fun there. We're going to make it.
But you are
going
to require the booster.
Everyone gets boosted. Before you go on stage, every time. I think there's a waning period where people are like, well, the vaccine effectiveness has dropped off.
Yeah.
Like, maybe if you keep hitting people, it'll come back.
Yeah.
Just boost them every fucking week. And maybe if you die, you were supposed to.
Yeah.
I mean, people are always saying that the roads are too crowded here.
For
now.
Sure.
But what if we boost a lot of people and whack a few?
I mean, that makes a lot of sense. I want to thank you for taking your time.
My pleasure.
You're a busy guy. Ben's going to get you. We promise you $50. Ben, go to the ATM. Get him the money.
I want
to
thank you.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for being one of these new up-and-coming people that's very exciting, and I think you're paving the way for a lot of people that are seeing what you're doing.
Wow.
Seeing you're courageous. You're a wild motherfucker. You take chances. You're smart. It's awesome.
Well,
I love
thank
being
you
around
for doing this.
And I'm happy to be your friend.
Well, I am happy to be your friend, and thank you for giving me the strength to be a gamer and be trans. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you, Joe.